tonight, if you're lost and do not know Jesus Christ, it'd be a wonderful night for you not to forget about for the rest of your life. Maybe today, maybe this evening, you might give your heart and life to Jesus. And that's what it's all about. Amen. Brother Dane, if you would, stand and open us up in prayer. Mark, you would take us to the front.
Jesus made sick people well. He even made the dead live again. What do you think about that? Pretty cool, huh? But some people, Jesus chose 12 men to be his disciples. He told them that God loves us so much and that he sent Jesus to die for us. But some people didn't want to hear about God. They didn't want to listen to Jesus. They wasn't very smart, were they? And we still have people, you know, today that aren't very smart. They don't want to listen either. On Palm Sunday, Jesus rode into Jerusalem. People shouted, "Hosanna to our King." They were the smart people. Later, Jesus and his disciples ate the Passover supper. Jesus washed their feet to show how much he loved them. After supper, they went to a garden to pray. But the men who didn't like Jesus sent soldiers to arrest him. That wasn't very nice, was it? Jesus was sent to die. His disciples were very, very, very sad. But Jesus had told them that he would rise after 3 days. He was going to come back to life. On the third day, women, I was one of them, went to Jesus' tomb. The tomb was open. Jesus was not there. But that night, Jesus' disciples were in a locked room. Suddenly, Jesus was there. He was alive. I wonder how he got into a locked room. Any ideas? He didn't need a key, did he? No. He just came in. He just appeared because he's Jesus. He can do anything. Jesus said, "Go and tell everyone that if a person believes in me, they will be saved, and they will live forever." So what are we supposed to go tell people? That if they believe in Jesus, that they can be saved, right? This is the Easter story, that Jesus is alive today. And because he died for us, we will live too. Now, everybody got a puppet? Y'all want to sing a little song with me? What? I'll tell you about Easter. Jesus loves us. He loves us all. Let's sing that song, okay? Now, let's sing. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Yeah.
can only imagine when that day comes, when I find myself standing inside. I can only imagine when all I do is forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Saw them bury him in the tomb. There's no doubt what everyone saw. And now you are concerned about your future, your safety. As a follower and one of his disciples, you are now huddled together behind a locked door. Yes, fearing those who killed him are coming for you. For your family? Can you imagine just how worried you are now?
Thank you.
more hope. You know Jesus came and stood with you, among you, and yes, doubting Thomas has his moment to touch Jesus' hands, his scars. Are you imagining that you are doubting Thomas? Then maybe the person beside you is. He loves us more than we can ever imagine. Yes, he is our Lord, our Savior. Jesus Christ is no longer dead. With your imagination, you have witnessed so much. You saw that he is alive again. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, yes, we all can be forgiven of our sins. We only just have to start with believing. Because Jesus raised from the dead, we can live forever. If we decide to truly follow him and not be ashamed, but to share with others what he did for us, there's no doubt we have hope. There's no doubt we have a future in heaven someday. Wow, what a glorious day that will be.
Thank you.
he's just got a couple comments that'll follow, but as I was sitting there and I was listening, man, I love the children, and I'll tell you why. The Bible says that out of the mouth of babes, we learn it. We'll just pay attention long enough. We'll learn what it is to worship the Lord. We'll learn what it is to understand and to trust the Lord as a little child. As I was sitting there thinking, and David said, why don't you give the altar call and then I'll say some things. And I got to thinking about someone, and just maybe tonight, you're thinking, what is all this? I read over and I think it's the 38th chapter of Job, where Job finally gets to talk to God. And God comes and he says, who is this that has come to ask these questions? Who is this that thinks they know it all? Were you there when we laid the foundation of the earth? Were you there when we put it all in? And I thought about this one. I meant to bring it up here to read it, but he said, were you there when I told the waves only to come this far? Amen. Were you there when I told the waves you've got to stop right here? And the Bible says proud waves would come. You notice that. If you've never been to the beach, you've never understood you don't understand what it's like to stand on the sand right here and watch an ocean, a vast ocean, stop right there. That's power. That's power. That is God. That's power. Simple. 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 See, the Bible talks about Jesus being the cornerstone. And there's two ways that you face the cornerstone. Either you fall upon the stone and be broken. That's where we're at right now. Or the stone will come and grind you into powder. That's judgment to come. Not only that, I talk about Wayne Runyon said this. I gotta give him credit still yet. I just heard it. He said, we're so close to the marriage supper of the Lamb, we can almost smell it. What's that mean? We're that close to this thing winding up. We are close to Jesus splitting the eastern sky. And this thing, done. The door shut, just like on the ark. I won't shut it. Daniel won't shut it. Ronnie won't shut it. Road Dog won't shut it. Billy Graham won't shut it. President of the United States won't shut it. God's going to shut the door. And when he shuts it, you're going to be, well, what about me? And he's going to remind you of some old silly red-headed preacher up there got a microphone and simply said, you need to come and be born again. You need to be saved. This isn't a game. We live in a time where people say it's a game. You just believe what you want to believe and you'll make heaven. Friend, that's not the case. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. That's what Jesus said. You can't go any other way. And whether you understand it all or not, Jesus simply put it in these terms. All you must have to do is believe that I am who I say that I am. Hebrews 11:6 says, it is impossible to please God without faith. He that cometh unto me must believe that he is. Number one, that he is. Comma. And that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. That's simply coming, friend. That's all that it is. And the reward, it isn't money in your pocket. It isn't a new car. It's eternal life. It's eternal life. It's what we celebrate down here is gold on our finger and gold around our neck. And some people got gold in their mouth. And we're going to walk on it over there. It's pavement over there. That's how much it's worth. because there's going to be so much of it. My father is rich. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills and hills too. And he's willing to pass it out to whosoever will. You say, well, I'll be rich in this life. No, but there is a life coming where moth and rust doeth not corrupt. Jesus is passing out tickets every day. Had one passed out this morning. Man came and gave his heart and life to Jesus. The place where we held revival, they had one happen there this Sunday morning. Brother Brian Townsend, my good pastor friend down in Georgia, had four pass from death unto life this morning. There were people saved all over the place. Jesus is passing out tickets left and right to whosoever will come get them. And you just got to come and get it. You just got to come and get it. Believe that he is. And that he is a rewarder of men that diligently seek him. I'm going to ask for one more verse, and I'm going to let Brother Dan come. One more verse. If you need to be born again, boy, that's not really hard to explain, but all at the same time, it's kind of difficult to explain. How about this? If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you need to come and know Him. You need to come and let us introduce you to this man named Jesus, who will change your life and who will change your ending forever. As we get a verse of song, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, would you come? I could ask you to raise your hand. I could ask you where you've been. None of that matters. You just need to know. Do you know Jesus? If you don't, would you come and give your heart and life to Him? How about you? Sing me one verse.
It's 249.
249. Would you come?
Telling me about, he just started in, he said, I asked him, I said,
said, "Are you saved, Jason?" He said, "Well, I went to the altar and I was baptized, but I was shortchanged.
Oh.
I didn't know exactly how to take it." And I said, and Mrs. Mean spoke up and said, "He needs to be saved."
Oh.
And I was thinking that maybe he was saved and just wondered, "Huh?" And then they corrected me. Jason corrected me. He said, "No. I went to the altar for all the wrong reasons. I went to the altar because I was trying to get my family back. I was trying to get out of drug rehab. I was doing everything, and I went to the altar and was baptized for all the wrong reasons. I was shortchanged." It dawned on me that he got religion and sought after religion and didn't get salvation.
Amen.
So I said, "Jason, would you like to pray now? You're talking like you would like to pray." Look at me, and he said, "Yes, I would. But here's the thing. Mrs. Mean's son, now on deathbed, never has a mood spoken or anything for a week. And when she said he needs to be saved, he went, and then when she said it again, he needs to be saved, the one in the coma that's passing on, Basin went twice. And I said, "Jason, I don't know about you, man. That seems like a confirmation to me that God is using this man that is dying, passing out this life into the next any moment to move enough to confirm to you that you need to be saved." That was his desire for his nephew to be saved. Jason said, "I want to pray." And we prayed. He accepted the Lord, and the next thing I lost him, he was outside and up down the hall telling everybody he got saved. And you know, I need to tell him, I said, all my life, this is the first time that someone that was on their deathbed had more influence than someone standing and talking. God used him. God used him. This has been the strangest thing that I have ever ran across. I even told Mrs. Bean, I have, as a pastor, I've done a lot of things in my life, but I did not know how to confront this, Kenny. I just really didn't. I didn't know what to do. But God, in his mercy, saved his last breaths to teach me that it's never too late to say, "I accept Jesus in my heart." It's amazing. Kenny and I will talk tomorrow. We're going on in life. And I'll share with you this morning what I feel is the last sign of the coming of Jesus Christ. And Brother Ronnie Armstrong has helped me with this. And Brother Rick over there. Matter of fact, Brother Rick is going to be teaching for me next Sunday morning. You gotta watch him now, just because he's married to Clay. You gotta watch him. So go watch him and make sure he does a good job. But I want to read to you, and I want you to write this down. It comes out of Luke 21st chapter. I'm gonna read it, and then we'll give you some information. We're going on. "And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars. And of on the earth distress of nations with perplexity. The seas and the waves, they are roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the power of the heavens shall be shaken." Listen to this. "And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in his glory with great power. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth."
Amen.
Look up. Ronnie Armstrong preached it every night. Look up. look up. Things are happening in the heavens. I am so sincere about this. I'm calling a meeting for my immediate family. We're going to have dinner, and I'm going to tell them that the time, and Kenny just said it, very, very near.
Yeah.
If you don't believe me, do this, and it'll prove itself. Go out in the morning and try to look at the sun in its sunrise. You used to be able to look at the sun. You can't no more. And if you look at it real close, you'll see more than just the sun. Get a welder's lens and look at it. You will see more than just the sun. Now, this is what I'm going to give you for your study. This is your homework.
There you go.
And if you have complaints with this, go to Kenny. I don't really want to hear. Write this down. N-I-B-I-R-U, Nineveh. Go on YouTube. Don't go on anything else but YouTube. And you look this up. Nineveh. N-I-B-I-R-U, Nineveh. Go to VP Earthwatch on Google. Look up Planet X. And you can also go to bpearthwatch.com. Stand with us. We'll get ready to go home. I want to end in prayer tonight. Cindy, thank you.
How about Dan?
How about
Dan?
How about what?
Dan.
Did I say Cindy?
Raise the Lord in three. Ready? Real life. One, two, three.